Okay, first question. Lillian, 是台湾?
I did not purpose.
Hi friends, so today we're gonna do a Q&A. I'm gonna answer some of your questions about my personal background, my career. I kind of held off on doing a Q&A because I was like, I don't know if anyone is gonna ask me any questions, but I give it a try and thank you guys so much for sending me your questions on Instagram. And how this is gonna work today is Albert, who is my boyfriend slash assistant for the day, is going to ask me questions while I prep for lunch today. This brings us to today's sponsor, Green Chef. Now that I'm primarily working from home, the question of what's for lunch, what's for dinner really haunts me. I oftentimes spend hours finding recipes to make and shopping for the ingredients. But with Green Chef, it's easy to cook clean, delicious meals through their step-by-step recipes and pre-measured ingredients that save your time. Green Chef is also a CCOF certified organic company and has options for every lifestyle, from keto plus paleo, vegan, gluten-free, vegetarian, fast and fit, and Mediterranean. Green Chef is perfect for those days when I'm busy working and didn't plan in advance what to cook for. They make cooking super easy by helping with meal planning, grocery shopping, and most of the prep week after week delivered right to your door. Green Chef's expert chefs curate every recipe so you can enjoy nutritious, restaurant quality dishes at home. I've tried three of their recipes and they're all so delicious. My favorite is the Sriracha Tamari Beef Bowl, which I'm going to make today. You can also use my code lillian.chiu.nyc to get $130 off plus free shipping on your first box. You can go to greenchef.com for more details. Okay, so what's the first question, Albert?
Okay, first question. Lillian, 是台湾... what was it?
Lillian 是台湾哪里人? I did that on purpose. 我是台北人。I'm 25 years old. I was actually born and raised in Taiwan, in Taipei.
大家好，我叫小文，我今年五岁，我爸爸妈妈都很在乎我，
But my life took a turn after graduating elementary school. So after sixth grade, my family decided to move to Vietnam because my dad has a business there. It was the most traumatic, but character defining year of my life. I went to international school in Vietnam for middle school and high school. That's also where I learned English. I barely knew how to speak English back then. And I remember just feeling like I was the dumbest person in school. At some point, I remember also bringing like a dictionary in class with me. The moment I like whip out my dictionary, I got weird looks from my classmates. Quite a dark time in my life. At that time, like my parents don't speak English and they really can't help me, but it was also that experience made me realize I have to be 100% responsible for my own growth. When I'm feeling into uncertainties, I'm not as scared anymore because I know that I will survive and I will work through it. I then came to New York for college. I went to NYU, I studied music business. Throughout my college career, I did a bunch of internships because I really wanted to make sure I could get a job out of it in the States. Graduated in 2019. I moved to Miami to start my internship at Spotify as a strategy and analytics intern. After 3 months of that, I was able to convert full-time on the same team. I was living there for almost 2 years. That's when Spotify rolled out the Work From Anywhere program where you can work anywhere within the US. With that, I moved back to New York. And yeah, that's where I am right now.
Next question. Has your life changed since moving abroad, or is it still as it was back in Taiwan?
Yeah, it definitely changed a lot. I learned how to be extremely independent. Like, I remember after I moved here, I had to deal with, you know, moving, navigating school and culture in the US, and also interviewing, recruiting, working in the States. Everything I felt like I had to learn and do myself. I couldn't rely on my parents because, like, you know, they're physically so far away. It's also taught me how to have the grit and perseverance to, you know, reach my goal.
Was it hard to get a job after graduation as a foreigner in the States?
Yes. It was so hard, and if you're going through it as an international student, props to you. I know it's terrible. I remember, like, whenever I hop on calls with recruiter, the moment I tell them I'm an international student, I need a sponsorship, they would just be like, oh, we don't sponsor. And then it's like they shut the door on me right away. My biggest tip is to start gathering as many experiences as you can in school. I also realized a lot of times companies just don't have the budget to, you know, sponsor international students. It tends to be the tech companies who are more willing to have the budget and sponsor you. Like when I worked in, you know, media companies and record labels, none of them would want to sponsor, especially for like entry level. It sucks going through it. I definitely feel you.
Hey Google, set the timer for 16 minutes.
Second timer for 16 minutes.
So what's your go-to fashion style?
Now my fashion style is more like a leisure and loungewear, basically anything that's like comfortable for me to lounge in. My favorite brands are Aloe Yoga. I love their sweatshirts. I also love Everlane. They have really good quality clothes. Oh, I also really like Kith. If I want to dress up a little bit more, I go to revolve.com.
What's your favorite thing to do on weekends?
Oh, one second. Honestly, I'm a big homebody. Like, my favorite thing to do on the weekend is stay home, watch Netflix, call my parents on FaceTime. I'm really close to my family, and then I try to call them at least like an hour on the weekend. I'm someone who like gets energy from being at home and being alone or like being with close friends, and then try new coffee shops. Although, Albert always yells at me when I buy like $7 coffee.
What's your dream job when you were a kid?
Ooh, my dream job when I was a kid. Okay, so I really wanted to be a teacher because I love teaching people things and like that feeling when I can help other people understand something. And I remember in elementary school slash middle school, I really wanted to be like an office worker working a 9-to-5 in a fancy office. And it was so funny because I would buy all these like cute notebooks and write down my to-do list for the day and acting like I'm all busy and stuff. I speak Mandarin fluently. I can write, read, and everything. English, same. So it's interesting because my primary language was Mandarin for the first 12 years of my life. For the last 12 years of my life, my primary language was English. So let's say if I'm in a professional setting or if it comes to like me having to articulate myself, then I prefer speaking English. I think in English. And when it comes to like just day-to-day conversation, talking with family, with friends, I prefer speaking in Mandarin. Oh, and I do know how to speak a tiny, tiny, tiny bit of Vietnamese, like basically just for me to get by at restaurants or like when I go outside. What happens when you forgot about plating? It's the taste that matters, right? So this is my beef bowl. Can't forget about the seeds and toppings. Which are the peanuts.
Mmm. Oh my god. So good.
What's your love story with your boyfriend? Albert, you want to say this?
We met in college.
But we're gonna talk more about this in a separate video. Do you know what you want to do with your life? 5-year plan, having quarter life crisis. First of all, I feel you so much on having quarter life crisis. I don't know exactly what I will be doing in 5 years, but I would like to think that I could have something of my own that I fully own and built from 0 to 1. I think that idea really came to me when I realized like no matter how hard I work at a company and no matter how prestige the company is, at the end of the day, I am helping the CEO realize his or her dream. But of course, I get to learn a lot of things from working for someone, but I started asking myself like, what about me? What about my dream? To get there, I've been interested in product manager career, just to learn like how to even build things from 0 to 1. I also think that YouTube is such a good practice of being an owner of my channel and my content and like how I want to present myself to the world. Physically, I definitely see myself moving back to Asia because I do want to stay closer to my family. Going back to the topic of quarter life crisis, I have also been going through the same thing. Quarter life crisis hit me when I turned 25 last October. It was when I asked myself the question, if I have all the resources and money in this world, what would I want to do? And my answer is, I don't know. And that really scared me because how would I not know what I want to do? And that's when I realized all these years I was working towards goals that the society deems is successful. For instance, getting into a good college, having internships, getting into a good job, working in tech. I realized in the pursuit of obtaining these goals, I was also losing my own voice on who I am and what my purpose is in this world and what impact I could bring. After a lot of soul searching, I think my purpose now is to, I want to be able to help others see their potential. And if that means sharing what I know throughout my own journey, I will do that. And that's why I started my YouTube channel and share it with you guys. What made you decide to launch a YouTube channel? Two main reasons. One, like I said, it's a result of my quarter life crisis. I was feeling really lost in like what my purpose and what impact I could bring to the world, which leads me to the second reason. Before I started my YouTube channel, even until now, I always get like
hundreds of messages on LinkedIn from students, new grads, asking about how I got into my Spotify internship, what is it like to work at Spotify. And I used to schedule weekly calls, but at some point I realized like that's just not efficient. Kind of inspired me to film a YouTube video and put it on YouTube so like I can just tell people, oh, you can watch it on YouTube. That's why my first two videos were about Spotify internships. And it was so interesting because like when I was filming for those videos, I realized I really like to make YouTube videos. One thing led to another. I now have a YouTube channel. How did you learn to edit videos? I actually didn't take any editing classes. Like when I edited my first YouTube video, I had no idea what Final Cut Pro even was. I barely knew how to cut footage, how to even import footage. Everything I know today, I learned it from the internet, from YouTube. I think the more you do it, the more familiar you get with editing. If you look at my first video versus like my more recent video, you can probably see the difference in my editing skills. Now when I watch other people's video, instead of viewing it from a viewer point of view, I view it from a creator point of view. Like, oh, I really like that they put this angle this way. Or, oh, I see that they did this effect. Let me see if I can replicate that. Like finding out on YouTube how to do it. How would you know if business analytics is the right path for someone? If you are someone who likes problem solving, comfortable working in uncertainty, and if you're good at seeing through complex things, what skills should I have before becoming a business analyst? Well, you can check out my latest video on the core skills of a BA. I talk about the three core skills of a business analyst based on my own experience and then also how you can learn them. Tips on making small talks with coworkers, especially for interns. Love your videos. Thank you so much. Just remember this golden rule. People love to talk about themselves. Most people are really good talkers, but bad listeners. So your job is to let them talk, and then you insert yourself into their conversations appropriately. With that, there's three conversation starters that I like to do. The first one is compliments. So I'll be like, oh my God, I love your outfit. Where did you get that? Compliment always works, and it gets people talking. Then once they start talking, you go from there. You ask like, how's your day, by the way? The second conversation starter I like to do is just very generic. How's your week going so far? Once people say something, keep asking follow-up questions, but not in an annoying way. The third one is I like to approach my coworkers with like all these very broad philosophical questions. So I would be like, hey, I have a question for you. How did you decide to become a BA? Just out of curiosity. It really gets people talking because like, if you think about it, in their day-to-day, nobody asks them that those type of questions. Whenever I ask those questions, like people will start sharing their life stories, their career stories, and then I insert myself in there and like ask like advice. What is the best and worst part of being a business analyst? The best part is the breadth of knowledge that I get to have on different subject areas. As a business analyst, you have a generalist role, meaning that you generalize across multiple topics versus a specialist role where you specialize in one thing. Let's say I know a little bit about product development, a bit about marketing, a little bit about partnerships, a little bit about data science. I feel like a ninja, but I never get bored on my job because there's always new challenges coming through. But I think the worst part is also the best part, which is because I know so many different subject areas, that makes it hard for me to figure out like, what do I want to specialize in? Or like, do I want to specialize in anything? Most of my BA friends, they end up specializing in one subject area. So let's say I have a friend who is going to specialize in data science and become a data scientist. So the next question is more Spotify company specific. Does Spotify have stock-based compensation? Yes, our salaries include base salary and stock. How do I maintain a healthy 9-to-5 work-life balance? The first tip is to set boundaries for yourself. And I know it is so hard. Let's say if my manager asks me to do multiple tasks in a very short period of time, if I know this is going to lead me to overworking, then I will tell her very transparently, I will tell her, hey, I'm running on tight bandwidth this week. Can we prioritize what's important for this week? And I'll work on those. And then we can have the other projects put to next week if that's okay. I don't think setting boundaries is a sign of laziness or weakness. I think quite the opposite. It's a sign of maturity and practicing self-respect. You also don't want to be labeled as that person that like says yes to everything and like tiring yourself out. I'll also try to understand like at what period of time am I the most efficient. For me, I realize I'm the most efficient from 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. That's like my peak performance time. I do the most difficult tasks, the hardest tasks in those hours, and then my day just feels a lot easier, a lot smoother. Favorite quote. Oh my goodness, I love this question. I have a favorite quote that I think serves me really well throughout my 20s. I find myself coming back to the quote a lot whenever I feel like I need an extra courage. The quote is kind of long. It is from Theodore Roosevelt, and I heard it from Brené Brown's podcast. It says,
"It's not the critic who counts. It's not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done it better. The credit belongs to the person who's actually in the arena, whose face is marred with blood and sweat and dust, who, at the best, in the end, knows the triumph of high achievement, and who, at worst, if he fails, he fails daring greatly. The moment that I read that, this is what shifted in me. It is not about winning, it's not about losing, it's about showing up and being seen.
It's such a good quote in a way that makes me have so much courage to do things that I am afraid of failing. As an example, when I started on my job at Spotify, I had this tremendous amount of self-doubt. I knew nothing, I had no prior experience. I think it's after reading this quote that I realized it's not about what I know, but more so the effort I'm willing to put into to learn the things I want to learn. How did I decide what I wanted to do for a living? Instead of identifying what I want to do, I was identifying what I want to learn and along the way figure out what I was good at and what I was not good at. My mentor once told me, let the path lead you. And with that being said, that's the end of our Q&A today. Thank you guys so much for submitting your questions. I'll probably be doing more of a career deep dive Q&A in the future, but in the meantime, if you have any questions, feel free to add your comments. Thank you guys for watching. I'll see you in my next video.